As the nationalist support crumbled, Labour's held steady. By the autumn of 78, some Labour strategists thought they would win a quick election, but Callaghan delayed.
There was I, waiting at the church. All at once, he sent me round a note. Here's the very note. This is what he wrote.
It was the most incredible and stupid decision of the century, political decision. I'm absolutely certain.
Now, let me just make clear that I have promised nobody that I shall be at the altar in October.
He had made the promise to the SNP over 2 or 3 years that that government would deliver the devolution. And if we'd gone in September, October 78, there wasn't a devolution through.
Although heavily amended, the new Scotland Bill finally made it through the Commons. Work began on the Assembly buildings. The final obstacle, the referendum, would take place in March, if Labour was still in office. Callaghan's decision to postpone an election meant his government faced a winter mired in industrial unrest. It was hardly the right backdrop for a referendum campaign.
I can remember the posters with Jim Callaghan's face on them saying, "Say yes," and this was immediately after the winter of discontent. The campaign suffered from the fact that the Labour Party had planned it well in advance. So nobody wanted to say yes to Callaghan on any subject at all. It was a disastrous mistake.
The Labour Party would not soil its hands by working with the SNP. This was a joint campaign.
Of course we should have had a more concerted campaign. There were some people in the Labour Party who wouldn't meet at all with the Scottish Nationalists, and maybe that helped to injure it.
Good afternoon. Now's the day and now's the hour for Scotland and devolution, or it should be. Scotland is still saying yes, but only just. And as we forecast on the News at 10 last night, it's saying yes well below the target of 40%.
At first, falling at the 40% hurdle seemed to destroy Scottish hopes for an assembly. But the nationalists knew the government couldn't give up devolution altogether. There might still be ways around George Cunningham's blocking tactics.
The Prime Minister on his Sussex farm is saying nothing. Mrs. Thatcher and the Scottish Nationalists have declared themselves ready to bring the government down. If they do try to get devolution, said Mrs. Thatcher. If they don't try to get devolution, say the Nationalists.
Would you bring down the government if it didn't deliver on this?
Since there is a majority in the form in which issues are normally decided in the UK, the government will have to deliver. And the government cannot depend on us for any kind of life insurance unless they deliver quickly.
They have one last chance. And if they don't take that last chance, then we must vote against them. We must do everything we can to get everybody in the House of Commons to vote against them. And if that means, Mr. Chairman, going in for the fancy Dan parliamentary tricks that they appear to be looking forward to, then we would do it.
At a party meeting in Dundee, straight after the referendum, the Nationalists agreed to back Donald Stewart's ultimatum. They chose to give the government 1 month in which to take devolution forward.
We went to Callaghan, we said, look, Prime Minister, put the bill to the House. That's all we ask. And if we lose, we lose. But if you don't, you've 30 days.
But 1 week before the Nationalist ultimatum expired, the Prime Minister was still stalling.
The government is firmly committed to devolution, but before the House makes such an important decision, there should be a short intermediate stage.
Donald Stewart!
And is it not a reality that he is prepared to treat the Scottish people with contempt rather than face an early election?
Now confident of Nationalist support, the Conservatives delivered the coup de grace.
Devolution and the way it's been handled are the occasion for us to put down a no-confidence motion. Enough is enough.
On the night of the vote, angry nationalist MPs resolve to stick to their word. But for one, the decision was agonising. Hamish Watt had left the Tories to join the SNP. He could not bear the prospect of now helping bring down the government.
My constituency were determined that I would not vote down the government. And I was so glad of their backing. But it didn't prevail against the greater weight of opinion in the party. So as late as the night of the vote, I was still in touch with my constituency. And they were pleading with me not to go through that lobby to vote down the government. But in the end, my nerve failed me and I finally went through the lobbies with them. After I'd done it, I felt terribly badly because it was totally against my conscience. I tried to get into the other lobby to cancel my vote. But just at that moment, the doors closed and I couldn't get in.
The ayes to the right, 311. The noes to the left, 310.
Watt's vote had proved decisive.
I never felt so alone as I did that night. Despite the fact that there were 600 and odd MPs around me, I was completely on my own. I had done something against my better sense, my better judgment, and it aggravated me. Had I been able to go through that other lobby and cancel the vote, I think I could have lived with myself. But no, I burst out in tears when I realized the gravity of what I had done. I had lost a parliament.
I've read in history during the 19th century, English governments fell over the Irish issue. This is actually the first time since the Union that an English government fell as a result of the Scottish issue. So it's quite a historic situation in Scotland. I have absolutely no qualms about having done it, and I would do it again, irrespective of the consequences.
The Nationalists entered the coming election defiant, but a disenchanted public cast them back into the political wilderness.
My regret always was that the SNP didn't get it together in the way it might. Well, it was a lack of professionalism. It was politics, though. It was politics. It was hatreds and old enmities and real differences of opinion. And equals.
They were serving in a parliament that they didn't wish to be part of, and so it was rather awkward for them. I don't think that they ever got to grips with how to play the game, how to get what you want in the Westminster Parliament.
But in burying the SNP, the Labour government dug its own political grave. The Nationalist parting gesture was to prove catastrophic for both parties.
I don't think they knew what the hell they were doing. The government failed to provide what we hope they provide. Therefore, we're going to kick somebody, and the government is the obvious people to kick. They didn't know they were shooting themselves in the head. They just thought they were shooting in some direction or other, and they hit the wrong target. But even power
to fire. It was to be a generation before the struggle for Scottish Home Rule forced its way back to the political arena. We are